There's a whole lot of serious consideration going on.
From the Battelle Studio at WOSU at COSI, this is Columbus on the Record. Joining Mike Thompson this week, Laura Bischoff, State House reporter for the Dayton Daily News. Chrissy Thompson, State House reporter for the Cincinnati Inquirer. Terry Casey, Republican strategist, and Sandy Tice, director of Progress Ohio.
John Kasich says now he is seriously considering running for president. Speaking just below Kasich's Rife Center office, Jeb Bush told the Ohio Chamber of Commerce this week he's seriously considering running for president. Most agree Jeb Bush has already decided, but it looks more and more like John Kasich will run. In Columbus, Bush stressed core conservative economic principles, while in Detroit, Kasich stressed the value of compromise.
It seems to me that our country, to be successful, we're going to have to create a high-growth strategy, growth above all else, if you will. A strategy that is forged on the belief that this country can be young and dynamic again, that we can grow at 4% rather than the so-called new normal of 2%, and that incremental growth compounded out, as far as the eye can see, will create major opportunities for those that are stuck in poverty and right now have lids on their aspirations, and those in the middle that are getting squeezed.
You know, what a great leader does is a great leader figures out how to bring people together. Or my mom used to say to me, Johnny, it's okay to compromise, but don't compromise your principles. I've been involved in more negotiations, more compromises, more conclusions to the betterment of what happens in our country when we can work together.
So, Laura Bischoff, is the mystery over now? Is John Kasich going to run?
I tend to think that he is going to run, and I think Jeb Bush is going to run as well. They're both kind of staking out the moderate Republican with executive experience stuff. It was interesting. I went to both the Ohio Chamber event and then also up to Detroit for the Economic Club. And they both talked about unity and leadership and experience. And honestly, I kind of felt like I was listening to the same speech. It was remarkable.
The fact they both said in the same week, when they're seriously considering it. They're playing from the same playbook, it seems like.
Well, but I think the governor is a little more in the be prepared mode, because the truth of the matter is Jeb Bush has got easier and quicker access to the big money. He's got the big name ID, but I think the governor wants to be ready, and this Sunday he's going to be on Meet the Press. A lot of national people are coming into Ohio. They're wanting to interview him. They're wanting to talk to him. So it doesn't mean he's 100% going to run, but I think he wants to be prepared.
I can't believe he markets himself as a uniter. He's the person whose office inserted the more offensive provisions in the assault on collective bargaining. Toledo Blade got a hold of some public records that prove that. He gives a speech on civility and he calls a police officer an idiot twice on tape and said he'd improperly ticketed him and was rude, and the dashboard camera showed just the opposite.
But he did put the Medicaid expansion, which went against his party.
And that helped fund his tax cuts. And to watch him market himself as a nice guy, I just find astonishing.
Well, but Sandy, the voters of Ohio, they had a little say in things last year.
Yeah, my team nominated.
He carried 86 of the 88 counties, including the big prize of Cuyahoga County.
I know he did.
Not many Republicans do that.
I know he did, but I still think his record, once it gets the scrutiny that it needs to get, people are going to realize he's a phony.
There's a lot of buzz in the political class and the political reporters, but he's still barely registering in the polls, John Kasich. When does that have to change for him to be a serious candidate?
It needs to start changing now. He is getting a lot of national attention, and I do think that he would play well in what we call earned media. You know, that a lot of reporters are going to write about him because he's different. He's interesting. He's you never know what he's going to say, and you know. So the question is, when is that going to start sinking into the average person? And he needs to really kick it into gear if that's going to happen.
Laura, I'm curious how the response was in the crowd in Columbus to Jeb Bush. I mean, this is Kasich territory, the Ohio Chamber of Commerce, generally allies of the governor, Ohio's governor. How did they view?
Sure, but I think they liked what they heard him talking about, like tax cuts and education reform, and you know, a lot of the immigration reform, a lot of the things that John Kasich talks about. So I think you know, I don't know that they're all going to rush out and start writing checks to his campaign. I'm sure some of them have, but you know, I think that they certainly it was a polite reception.
Terry, how are Republicans viewing Jeb Bush? I mean, you watch him; he's different than his brother. But he still has some of the same mannerisms as his brother. When he talks about foreign policy, it's vaguely familiar to what his brother's foreign policy was. How are Republicans viewing him?
Well, they know he's going to have money and he's got name ID, but from the clip you just showed, that 2% growth rate versus 4% growth rate, I'm not sure how much that excites a lot of people in Ohio, because that's kind of
But that was to a Chamber of Commerce business audience.
But still, he does have a reputation, which is good, of being more intellectual than George W., but he's still searching for the right message, because there is fatigue, whether it's Clinton or Bush, of we want somebody new.
The question is, though, there is the Bush fatigue, and that would give John Kasich possibly a lane. But is it enough of a lane that he can totally pass a guy who has great name ID when Kasich registers at, you know, 0 to 2% in national and regional polls? You know, can he leapfrog a guy who's going to have double, triple, maybe even quadruple the amount of money that John Kasich would raise, even though he started to raise money?
Well, but I hate to bring back American history. 8 years ago, people were swearing there's no way a guy with a name Barack Obama that nobody's heard of could beat one of the Clintons. So one of the great things about American politics is things do happen that's not always predicted. And I remember Bill Clinton, people swore that there's no way he could win after his problems and other issues that came up.
All right. While Governor Kasich seriously considers battling Republicans running for president, he already has a fight on his hands with Republicans in the Ohio House. They like the governor's tax cuts, but not so much his tax hikes. The House budget includes an income tax cut for individuals and small businesses. They are smaller cuts than what the governor wants. But the House says no to the governor's increases in the sales tax, the cigarette tax, the fracking tax, or the commercial activities tax. Chrissy Thompson, is this anti-tax principle that's behind the House budget, or is it pressure from business groups?
I think it's a little bit of both, probably more the latter. The chamber, most chamber groups in the state came out blatantly against all parts of the governor's tax plan, said that they, you know, didn't want to see these tax increases and that the tax cuts, the income tax cuts, didn't justify them. And that's a really hard thing for Republican lawmakers to swallow. However, remember that two years ago, House Republicans rejected all portions of the governor's tax plan. A little bit more was added in the Senate. And really, what the governor's people work toward is getting people to come to a consensus in that final last week or two when the two chambers are meeting together, and suddenly all sorts of things show up. So, never say never.
Well, and Chrissy stole part of what I was going to mention. The state Senate and what they do and how they operate is different. And part of the magic of the conference committee right at the end is the governor does have the ability to line item veto things. So sometimes there could be some horse trading, other things that go on. So
it's actually magic that happens at the conference committee. I've been wondering all these years.
There's a lot of magic that happens.
A lot of magic.
Well, and there's the conference committee of the six people. Then there's the side game. So there's a lot to happen, and there's a lot of people in the state Senate. There's a reason why the governor is very praiseworthy of Keith Faber, because Keith Faber can be helpful in blocking things he doesn't want and helping things he does want. Doesn't mean the governor's going to get it all, but he's going to do better than he's doing right now.
Sandy, is this budget more palatable than for two Democrats than the governor's budget? There is an income tax cut, but it's not as large as what the governor wanted.
It's a tax shift, and what it does is it shifts the burden onto the people who are least able to pay it, and then it cuts taxes dramatically for the 1%.
But there's no sales tax expansion here, which is really
aggressive. No, there's not, but the income tax cut is huge, and we have a progressive income tax, so the more you make, the higher rate you pay, and he wants to put an average of $1,300 in the pockets of the very truly wealthy. And
but Sandy, you should be happy. The Ohio House didn't gut out the Medicaid expansion that you and many other people like so much. So there's progress. I mean, the governor, again, no governor ever gets all that they want.
No, he doesn't.
But I think he's doing decent, and he'll do better as the
weeks go ahead. Well, he got a lot of money from the federal government because of that, and that helps balance our budget. I mean, he would have really been insane to not embrace the Medicaid expansion, particularly in a state like Ohio.
I'm glad you said he's not insane. We'll take that as progress for the governor.
Laura, the fracking tax, again, dies on the vine, at least for now.
the House has been adamant against increasing the taxes on the oil and gas producers. And it's interesting to me because Kasich keeps battering through, he keeps pounding away at it. He makes very strident statements about this. This is something he really thinks is unfair, that they're not paying their fair share in his view. But I don't see the House moving on that at all.
Will it go to the ballot? If the governor
that's the other threat, is they could take it to the ballot, but that would be very costly.
Yeah. Well, and if you don't have the support in the House to get it on the ballot, it would require the signatures, and the deadline of early July is coming up very fast. So, but that could happen in the future.
And that's an expensive undertaking to get something on the ballot.
It's not going to happen this year. But the governor has to decide what he wants to prioritize. Does he want to build a huge coalition and find money to get the fracking tax on the ballot, or does he want to run for president?
How hard is he fighting for this budget if he is going to South Carolina and Michigan and New Hampshire, and now he's seriously considering running for president? He's not going to be in Columbus to fight for this budget as much as he was 2 years ago.
I mean, he can't even get his own party in Ohio to follow him.
He's running, though. That's one of his
plans. That doesn't speak well for his leadership abilities.
Terry brought up a very important point, though, which is that if you watch who ends up going with the governor on some of these trips, Keith Faber showed up in New Hampshire, and I remember saying, why is the Senate president here? And someone said, oh, the governor invited him and put him right in the front row and, name-dropped him a few times. And he's working in his own way to get what he wants.
The governor, coming from the legislative branch, state Senate and Congress, he understands something about the legislature and how to accomplish some of your goals.
All right. Republicans are not the only ones having intra-party squabbles. Ohio Democrats seem divided over their candidates for U.S. Senate. The party has officially endorsed Ted Strickland as its choice to take on Rob Portman. Party leaders say the former governor has the best chance against Portman. One of the party's statewide elected officials, Supreme Court Justice William O'Neill, blasted the party for not staying neutral. He posted to Facebook, quote, "The brain trust who lost every single statewide office in 2010, his capital's letters, not ours, is back in charge. Run, people, run. The inmates are running the asylum." Cindy, tell you, should the party have stayed neutral in this fight?
I don't think so. I think maybe the endorsement was a little early. Primaries are helpful when you have two candidates who nobody knows and who are evenly matched. But Ted Strickland does have a very good chance of beating Rob Portman. There was just a poll that showed him up by 9 points. It showed Portman has some problems on the right because he endorsed marriage equality, which I thought was a great thing he did. He has a real problem with independence when he signed that letter to Iran that some people viewed as treasonous. I think that put him on the radar of a lot of people who really didn't know a whole lot about him. And the reputation he had at the beginning was, hey, he's a pretty nice, reasonable guy. And that letter was an eye popper to a lot of people. And I think people just said, sorry, PG, you're a city council candidate. Stay back for a while, and let's give it to the person who's most likely to knock off the senator.
Sandy, I got to tell you the rest of the story. 6 years ago, Lee Fisher was ahead of Rob Portman by 11 to 15 points.
But it Rob turned wasn't out the incumbent. Big difference.
But Lee Fisher ended up losing by 18 points. But here's the real problem. Since Justice O'Neill spoke out, the Inquirer had a very strong editorial. Today in the Cleveland Plain Dealer, Brett Larkin just blistered, in essence, the idiots and the labor people for not being very bright about things. And I see a guy like Jim Ruvolo, very smart out of Toledo, back in PG Sentinfield. So I think this trying to anoint somebody is not going to work out very well.
Well, I think those people represent the minority view in the party. A lot of the folks I've heard said, yeah, go Ted. I did think it was a little early. I mean, can you wait 6 months?
I think it's a failure to guide Sittenfeld into a different race. Going from city council race to U.S. Senate is a big leap. And, I think, they could have done more to try to guide him and maybe promise him a chance to run at something else, maybe one of the down-ticket statewide races. And I think it's also a failure of Sittenfeld to recognize that going against his party, is really going to damage his political future. If he wants to be the new face of the party, then going about it in this way is not helpful for his career.
Chrissy, how is this playing in Southwest Ohio and Cincinnati, Sittenfeld's backyard? I mean, he has to be popular down there. His hometown paper.
you know, blasted this process. Not surprising.
Yeah, he is, you know, he's a controversial candidate in Southwest Ohio because he flipped a stance on the most controversial issue in the area, which is the Cincinnati streetcar. So without going into that too much, you know, there is a feeling most of, I would say the majority of his supporters right now are from Southwest Ohio, and they're disappointed. A lot of young people who feel like the party has pushed them out, and that they're not being listened to.
Cindy, that's the how do the Democrats, we keep hearing they don't have a deep bench. Well, how do they deepen their bench if they're quashing young candidates this quickly?
I think he's on the bench. I think Nan Whaley, the mayor of Dayton, is on the bench. The people who lost, other than Ed Fitzgerald, statewide, those people are on the bench. We have some big city mayors. I get tired of hearing there's no bench. There's a bench. And there's a new person in charge of the party. I like what I see so far. And Laura's right, though. They should find a home for PG.
But as a person here with the most gray hair, I want to remind people, certain of these same bosses or similar bosses told Dick Celeste to wait your turn, but he didn't listen to him. He ran and went ahead and won.
He had a much more well-developed record than the Cincinnati City Councilman. I mean, the guy looks, I've never met him. He's impressive when I've seen him speak. He has a good resume. But in addition to flipping on the streetcar, he told a lot of people that if Ted Strickland got in the race, he would get out. And he made promises to a lot of Democratic Party leaders that he would do that, and then he didn't do that. That's not how you want to introduce yourself.
I think that that is the reason why what Laura is talking about did not happen. I think that there were conversations where party leaders felt like we have, okay, PG will drop out if Ted gets in. And he changed his mind, and you know, then now there's been kind of a lot of conflict, and what do we do about this situation? So that's why we are kind of having a little bit of a party fight over this endorsement.
Okay. We like party fights here on Columbus on the Record.
They are interesting.
Intra or inter, we like them all. Columbus voters in 3 weeks will narrow the field for mayor. Ironically, it's a nonpartisan primary. Four candidates face each other in the May 5th election. City Council President Andrew Ginther and Franklin County Sheriff Zach Scott appear to be the front runners, but the other candidates, former school board member Terry Boyd and community activist James Ragland, are making noise, mainly going after Ginther as well. The top two vote-getters, regardless of party, qualify for the November ballot. The race has taken a harsh turn, with Zach Scott and Andrew Ginther and their supporters sending out negative mailers attacking each other. Terry Casey, I have a question. Terry Boyd is the Republican on the ballot. His party affiliation is not on the ballot. Who are Republicans rooting for, really? Zach Scott or Terry Boyd?
Well, there's a lot of Republicans.
Unless they're rooting for Andy Ginther.
Well, that's one of the unique things. When there's no ballot name on there, it makes it very fluid. And part of the thing I brought along, I don't know whether your camera can get this, is the mailer I got at home yesterday from Americans for Prosperity. And there's been telephone calls. I think there's going to be a lot more mail coming. And this thing's going to get more heated. And last night at Channel 10, they had a very good debate. They behaved at your location here when they debated. Last night, they had the knives out and they were sharpened. And I think it's going to get a lot more so that way.
But are Republicans, I take it they would prefer Zach Scott over Andrew Ginther, do you think, if it came down to those two?
Well, if it's that in the fall, I think that might be a little more of a leaning. But right now, I mean, people feel a certain sense of freedom. But the question is, who's going to turn out and vote? How many even people know that there's a primary on May 5th?
Well, Andy Ginther is clearly the front runner, and that's why everybody was ganging up on him. And that's one of the reasons why the Koch brothers and Americans for Prosperity have funded that mailer. This is, what, the second or third one that's come out?
The second one.
Second one. And so if they're engaging this early, we're going to see a lot of them. And I think that's because they don't want him to win, because they know he's a strong candidate.
Well, I think the real reason is they put on there is the tax hike thing. And I think coming soon, there'll be a thing about why did Andy Ginther give away $1 million-plus parking lot for somebody to build a hotel, and somebody happened to give him tens of thousands of dollars in contributions. So that'll come out.
Why is this national group, granted they have a chapter here in Ohio, Americans for Prosperity, founded by the Koch brothers, they got involved in the zoo campaign last year, they were involved in the Gahanna City income tax campaign a couple of years ago, I think a few other races around the state. Why are they so interested in Ohio?
Well, part of it is they like issues where you can talk about taxes and go against somebody that was pushing big tax increases. But the other part of it, it's because Ohio. The more they can learn, test their technology and techniques in Ohio, it's the same reason there's a lot of people attacking Rob Portman, doing things. Ohio is one of the centers of the political universe.
So how does it play around the state, though, Chrissy?
Well, this is about building up a base, I think, for national campaigns. And, you know, anytime you can get people engaged on an issue, you learn information about them, you're able to influence them in other elections. And you know, Columbus is the capital of Ohio, and that's a really big deal. There are a lot of people here listening to all of this and hearing all this feedback that make a lot of big decisions that impact the whole country.
Sandy, the two issues are this Andy Ginther's role in the school board when he was there and the data readings began, and also the tax abatement. So those issues that the average voter really is going to pay attention to?
Andy Ginther got an anonymous tip about the data scrubbing, and he's the person who initiated the investigation. And when the school board decided...
Well, he passed it on to somebody else.
Yeah, but he did. He did. He didn't just say, I'm not going to do anything with this anonymous tip. And, you know, you guys get anonymous tips all the time, I'm sure, just like I used to. Terry's probably passing out some of them and not putting his name on them. But to take the initiative and do something like that, I think was a big deal. I feel like he's being swift-boated. And when the school wanted to come in and stop the investigation, he told the auditors to keep going.
But Sandy, if you actually read beyond the talking points they gave you from the Ginther campaign and look at Andy's interview on Channel 10, what happened is he not only ignored the two tips, not one, but then they fired the auditor who wanted to pursue it internally. So the problem is he looked the other way. He didn't share with the other board members. And also you ought to read Dave Yost's report on those problems. I mean, Andy Ginther's denials really don't check out when you look deeper at the actual facts.
Back to your original question, which is, do the voters recognize this? And I think that tax abatement, when you say tax abatement, the eyes start to glaze over. But if you're going to talk about cheating by the schools on the attendance ring, that thing that's been in the paper for months and months and months, and I think that has some legs.
It killed the school levy, partly, in addition to the overall level of the levy that certainly hurt it. One more topic. The shootings of unarmed black men by white police officers has prompted calls for officers to wear body cameras. Some departments like Cleveland soon will start using them. Other departments like Columbus are considering using them. While the cameras can help settle disputes over police use of force, they can also invade the privacy of crime victims and witnesses. So the question is, how much access should the public have to the videos taken by the body cameras? Laura Bischoff, are there any rules?
It's a very unsettled area of law. You do have to balance open government against these privacy issues. I mean, if the police show up and they're inside a house over a domestic violence issue, I mean, do you really want to have that video floating around for whoever to use? However, it raises all kinds of issues over privacy, over archiving, over redacting, and then also, but at the same time, I guess the Cleveland police, their policy has been, their proposed policy anyway, has been, we'll keep it all and we'll only release it at the discretion of the police chief. Well, that's pretty extreme.
Yeah.
But this is definitely
doesn't seem workable.
A challenging area, but I also know from some people who thought when they were drinking too much they weren't that drunk, and then when the media had the video that showed what was going on, they quickly shut up and realized they had a problem. So I think in some ways it'll help vindicate the police, because a lot of times people, when they've been drinking too much or other problems, they forget how they were misbehaving. So it can protect the police too.
But I see the mainstream press as being responsible if they do get these things, but it's the bloggers and the non-traditional press that think some of this stuff is funny. That's what makes me a little bit nervous.
Well, Sandy, I worry about TV stations, not this one, but certain TV stations during rating sweeps periods. If they get something juicy on videotape, it tends to get rerun 20 times.
It's similar to the 911 tapes. Yeah. I mean, it's a tough call sometimes. It's very compelling audio, but it's also people's worst moments, you know, terrible events. When do you use them? When do you not use them?
But at the same time, I think that a lot of the footage can be extremely revealing as to what happened. I mean, you look at the footage from the park where Tamir Rice in Cleveland was killed, and it was in direct contrast to what the police were saying.
We're going to get to our off-the-record comments, our final parting shots, and we will start with you, Sandy.
The voters had a big victory this week. The ACLU and the NAACP sued the state over restrictive voting hours. And the good guys won, and they expanded weekend and evening voting. And that was a big deal, I think, and I think we need to find more ways to increase voting opportunities as opposed to shrink them.
Well, actually, the big win was that it's uniform and the same in all 88 counties. And just to follow up, in the next week, you're going to really see the big negatives on TV, on mail, come in the Columbus mayor's race. So put on your boots, get ready, it's going to get muddy.
For a primary with 15% show up. Chrissy.
Well, we have never seen a vote in Ohio from lawmakers on Medicaid expansion because of it was expanded through the controlling board last year. And take a look next week. We might get an amendment on the floor that might actually put some lawmakers on the record about where they stand on Medicaid expansion.
And Laura.
And Hillary Clinton went through a line at Chipotle in Maumee unrecognized. My prediction is if John Kasich were to go through a Chipotle line at Nashua, New Hampshire, no one would recognize him.
But John Kasich won't be wearing sunglasses.
Well, you never know.
Yeah.
Following up on Sandy's remark, they did settle out of court this voting dispute, which allows voting on Sundays and other times. I predict that will not be the end of it. There will be court cases over Ohio's voting between now and November of 2016. At least one more case.
That's a gutsy call.
Maybe one in October, you think?
<That's right. laughs> That is Columbus on the Record for this week. Check us out online, Facebook, Twitter, our website, WOSU.org. For our crew and for our panel, I'm Mike Thompson. Have a good week.